Welcome to Bon Appetit Cook-Off Weed Week. We are here in Los Angeles celebrating. We have D Nasty with us. We have Miguel Trinidad in the kitchen. And of course, B-Real, host of Bon Appetit Cook-Off.
Hello, guys. You know, we got some of the best minds in the cannabis industry here with us tonight. And we're gonna have a great conversation, so welcome.
Matt Barnes, retired NBA player, cannabis advocate.
My name is Maul. The Joe Budden Podcast with Rory and Maul. And, a weed advocate for sure.
I'm Cheech, I'm the director of merchandise and the host of Sauce Talk on Viceland, and heavy weed advocate.
I'm Guap Dad 4000, also used to work in the NBA. I used to scout tickets. I'm a scammer turned rapper, and that's what I'm here for.
Jazz Waters, I'm a writer-director. I'm on Showtime's Kidding.
I'm DJ Nina Nine, SiriusXM Hip Hop Nation.
I'm Al Harrington, Gondrepreneur, owner of Viola Brands and Harrington Wellness.
I'll be right here. Tonight, we're gonna take you on a journey. So we wanna destigmatize cannabis through the universal language of food. A whole meal is gonna be about 20 milligrams, so you'll be able to pull back or consume. It's all up to you how you want to, you know, go on this journey. So here we go, guys. It's a take on a fried oyster. This is about 3 milligrams. It's gonna be a little bit on the saltier side, but I wanted to play with the flavors of the Insane OG that we infuse this with. It's piney, it's minerally. I wanted to bring out the salt. Enjoy the first course.
So what are some of everyone's funniest edible experiences? Who got funny ones?
I met a girl. And she came to go on a first date with me. She didn't know that I would be on that edible.
Right.
Thought it was a first date, so I'm like, I'm broke, baby, we're going to Denny's. We finna chop it up. At Denny's is when the edible hit. I said, I ate all this weed cake. I need help, and she told me to drink milk.
Right.
I don't know why I didn't get it from Denny's. I said, let's...
Because they serve milk.
Let's go to my house. Because my pops got milk. I don't live with my pops. He was in jail. There was no milk.
I'm from New York, right? And it's not legal in New York. So basically, anybody who's fucking around with edibles, they're just doing whatever they think is what it is. At least here, at least here, you know, you can dose it properly and, you know, you can take it in a way that you can measure what you're taking. Alcohol is so regulated. Alcohol is cool. Like, you can wake up and drink at 11 a.m. and it's called Sunday brunch. You know what I'm saying?
We're in prohibition right now.
Right.
Yeah.
Again, the whole alcohol of it was about taxes. Yeah. Once they could find a system to tax it and make money off of it, then it was legal.
But with edibles for so long, it wasn't regulated, and I've seen a lot of it. I've seen it take some of the best people out. And I never fuck with it, ever. I don't have no stories for you. I can't lie to you. I'll sit there and laugh at the people and get high with but I'm not gonna do that because you have no control over that shit.
I'm not mad. I was high for like a week. It felt good. So wait, like you go to sleep, you wake up. I was good.
When we think of an edible experience, we're always thinking of that time where we got too high, and then with legalization, that's what it will help to prevent, because there will be regulations on the edibles.
I think that's one thing too where, you know, myself and Al are working with UCLA on this cannabis research program, and we really feel like, I think our goal is to remove the word high from it and explain the educational side and the beneficial side of it, because I think people who don't know enough about it are afraid, I don't want to be high. No, I don't want to be high. I think that they steer clear of the word high. So I think if you can really, you know, obviously educate them and let them know the beneficial side, especially being an athlete and we can speak from experience, this is what it does for our bodies. It hits everyone different. You know, you may take to something different, but there's a part on that plant that can help everybody.
Yeah. You know, if we left it to a vote of the nation, you know what I'm saying, I think the cannabis would be legal, right? So we all know that right now the issue is the politics. You know, they're trying to figure out how to tax it. They're trying to figure out how to include big pharma. A lot of these states, they're always trying to create environments for the smaller people to fail. The one thing is that we do know, like, the community that was most negatively affected by cannabis was the Black community. So now we have this industry where, obviously, you know, our brothers and sisters are still locked up. But there's now an opportunity, and these Black caucuses are in this mindset of like, no, we don't want cannabis. And I'm telling them, I'm like, look, we cannot miss this opportunity because it's billions of dollars at stake, not for, for our communities.
I'm very aware of the fact like I'm on television cooking with cannabis while people are in jail for much less.
Yeah, facts.
Right?
Yeah.
So, but what I think that the show does and other cannabis content does is push the narrative forward. So it's not this thing that like, has this bad stigma.
I think about this every single time I go into a dispensary. How many of my cousins are sitting in jail for the same weed? And the truth is that the only difference between them and me is state and time. But this is all politics. So it's more than just the money that's out there. It's also access to the healing that's out there. It's also being able to participate in something that makes you better rather than sitting behind bars because you got to it first.
Like they said for years before it was legal, this is the number one cash crop, right? So it's about convincing conservative and religious voters.
Money talks.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Lobbyists.
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 Because realistically, a senator in the South or a congressman or a governor, you might not want to risk his seat. The game plan is, how do we convince them? The conservatives see the money behind it, so that's an easy, that's an easy win right there.
But once education.
Yeah, and it's all about education. It's about having those conversations you're talking about. But I think, you know, we're in a time where people are open-minded and they're hungry for information.
You get curious. Like when it starts to be more around, you're like, huh, okay, well maybe I could, oh, it works for my back pain. Oh, I have arthritis. I can take a bath in it. I don't have to get high.
Everybody thinks of weed and they're thinking about me getting high, but there's CBD that has a non-psychoactive properties. And it's like, I put my mom onto like the CBD cream and now she's always like, oh my God, my neck hurts. Like, can you bring me that thing? And it's like, there's so many properties to this plant that is so stigmatized. And it's like, there are so many things that you can do with it. If you don't want to get high, not everyone takes to being high. Like some people just can't deal with it. You know what I'm saying? But there are so many benefits to this plant and you can do it without having to be altered. For me, weed was always that thing that made me not feel like jumping out of my skin. You know, and now I know that that feeling of feeling like you're jumping out of your skin is what anxiety is.
A part of the high is like before you actually smoke. Like breaking the weed up, you know,
it's
rolling up. So if you have anxiety and you're doing that, that helps you, your mind relax, calm down, and then you smoke. I died off of edibles one night, though. I came back, though.
You came back?
I came back.
How? Yeah, explain, elaborate.
I was up and then I was down.
It's that simple.
Miguel, that smells really good. What's up with the second course?
It's called a salad.
It's called a salad. Well, I can smell it from over here.
That's for the third course, baby. We got some garlic and some ginger slowly browning.
Bring that salad over here. Miguelito.
All right, so, you know, we are in California. There's a lot of fresh produce, and the strains that we're using is not only the Insane OG, but we also got some stuff from Viola, from Al's company, and this shit is fire. I mean, it's strong as fuck, right? Because it has coconut oil, it's gonna absorb into your system a whole lot faster. So this is gonna hit you like in 15 minutes.
What's the funniest shit somebody sent to y'all on social media?
I had a guy who, he was like, I want you to humiliate me on live with like three of your girlfriends. And I just was like, I don't know, son. Like, I don't know if I could do that. He's like, yeah, like I'll wear your panties.
What?
Yeah, he wanted me to, he wanted to wear my panties. He wanted them to be specifically pink. I turned it down. That was the craziest thing that I had gotten in my DM. You know, other than the occasional dick pic and shit.
Who's gonna fall less?
Yeah, I hate him. Even though this see one the other day that I was like, oh, okay.
You get surprised, you see it, and you be like, okay, now the
No, but that's very rare.
Yeah, that shit is cool, but imagine being a dude who gotta deal with that who don't want to.
I mean, look, my whole thing is, if you get a dick pic, send them one back.
No.
If you're a girl, they'll be thrown off guard.
I get the occasional. The occasional, you know, big weed stunt. Somebody smoking through like a turkey or a, you know, cantaloupe or this or that. You know, they plague my shit with that. But you know, I repost it.
Right. Yeah, I like them.
Like you found it.
Some of it's good, you know.
You were basically one of the first people who started promoting weed. When you came out, like you were one of the first rappers. And everybody thought that if you were smoking weed, you was like on heroin and crack as well. You know, so. You were one of the first to kind of break through and open that up.
Right.
So tell us about your journey into that.
We for sure rolled up and smoked weed, but we also, you know, were fucking with High Times and getting information from High Times. We were constantly educating ourselves about the cannabis movement, going under the tutelage of Jack Herrera, rest in peace.
Which is a great strain.
Right, yes. But he's also a great man because he educated a lot of us through a book called Emperor Wears No Clothes. And we started seeing, like, from the, you know, in the 20s and 30s, the propaganda start shifting against cannabis. Throughout our career, we had obstacles and blocks, you know, because we were the cannabis group.
That's why people look at weed the way they do, because they're looking at all these other drugs that kids are really dying off of.
Right.
And they're putting all of these drugs in one lane.
I think it's also stereotyped as a minority thing.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? To keep it real. You know, I mean, people, first they want to get their foot in and get their position with the taxes and everything, but it's stigma as a, you know, you see rappers doing it or people who are lazy or you, like you say, it gets clumped in with the lean and the other shit because you always see people smoking when they're drinking, you know what I mean? So it's all gets clumped into one. So
like, is it legal now here?
No.
It's legal in Jersey, right?
They just postponed the vote that was supposed to happen last month. And even though like 60% of the residents and the governors like into it, like the Senate was like on some like, nah.
Throughout the licensing process, there wasn't enough diversity. And that's a huge issue in the industry because there's not enough black representation, black brown women representation in the space. So that's what it was about. They didn't want to monopolize this process. They wanted to make sure that, you know, that social equity would be addressed before they went recreational.
I think Miguel wants to give intro.
What are we eating?
This is pescado con coco, also known as sinuglay. It's local rockfish. So it's very similar to a red snapper. The coconut sauce that you see under it is infused with the Insane OG and the Viola strain that you guys gave us. A little bit of spice, a little bit of ginger, some brightness, coconut, all smoothed out, 5 milligrams. You're 12 milligrams.
12 pounds of drink?
Yeah, what's the drink?
The drink was 4 to 5.
Hey.
Enjoy, guys.
Thank you.
I just feel like the only way we're gonna affect change is like we gotta create jobs. You gotta create financial freedom. Like without money, you're gonna be miserable.
Would there be some way to do that with like a co-op system so like everybody could have a piece of, like say you did a manufacturing.
A co-op in the project?
Well, I mean like if you did like a manufacturing facility where all of the workers were invested in the facility.
You gotta back up for a second though, because what you're talking about is the poverty of low expectations. So if I'm on the street corner and I'm slanging or I'm doing whatever I'm doing, at the end of the day, I have chronic headaches. I don't know what's wrong, but I know that I don't feel well most days. I'm also desensitized to the idea of losing someone. So if I'm being told my life doesn't actually matter, a co-op does nothing.
Yeah. Until you stop like surviving, you can't really live. You know what I mean? Like, and that's basically what you're saying in a nutshell.
Desperation.
Like, just everybody desperate, needed. You know what I mean? It's like dead serious, a crab in a barrel. Everybody just trying to get to the top or just trying to live.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And you can't see your human side when your ribs is touching.
No.
And you know what I mean? You hungry or you cold and you ain't got no heat. We all know what it's like.
We think it's about raising the bar, and it's not. It's raising the ceiling. Right. Like, and it's something that you take for granted. And also, in a lot of ways, I grew up in the suburbs. I take it for granted. Right. And that you weren't in a situation where you had to actually, like, fight to just be considered a human being. And now you're talking about black men in low-income situations who aren't even allowed to cry or to even talk about what's happening to them. And then you want to tell them, put your guns down. Well, put it down, why? Why do I even matter?
So someone else can shoot
me. Right, exactly. So I think you have to start a long way before you do a co-op or any sort of job opportunity. It's giving people humanity.
In front of you, you have an olive oil cake, which you do with the butter baby. Okay, the panna cotta, we put some of the Insane OG in that and some orange zest. The berry coulis on the bottom are fresh berries that we picked up on Melrose Market this Sunday. Just, you know, cooked them down, made a nice sauce with it. This right here is about 6.5 milligrams. But this is where we give you the choice. If you feel it's too much, don't eat all of the cake. Take a small bite, have some of the panna cotta. That's the dangerous part because it's too delicious to pass out.
If we're gonna walk on ice, we might as well dance, baby.
You might as well.
Do it.
Damn. You gotta eat the whole thing.
Oh my God.
I'm ready to wrap this up and put it in my pocket, man.
This is so good.
So check this out. She had a good question while we were on the break for a second.
It's a trailer out right now for 420. For How High Part 2. The worst part is Meth and Red are not a part of it. They replaced them with Lil Yachty and DC Young Fly.
I think a lot of people do remakes of movies. I think it's okay to pass the torch. I think that the best way
but
would
not,
be
not that collab. Like that's a seat. Like you got two smokers.
I think they need to incorporate them in the movie somehow. Whether they're uncles now, whether they're
it's the equivalent.
It's not gonna be the same.
It's the equivalent of having a Cheech and Chong movie with other guys playing Cheech and Chong.
Exactly.
You put Wiz in it. You put like some other guys that are cooler. That really are associated with the cannabis like culture. We gonna go see
but
that.
Think,
I'm not going
think,
to go see that just because I don't
just,
think that DC Young Fly is gonna
did,
captivate
but they
my.
They should have just renamed the movie. They shouldn't have used that How High title. They should have just did a different name.
Even if they went with another title, nobody was going to see that. Yo, get this cake away from me.
Yeah, please. It tastes mad good.
Hey, Miguel, come get this cake.
Get these cakes, man.
The service came and picked up everything else quick. They ain't gonna leave these sitting in front of us. Yeah. Nah, come get this shit,
good,
man.
Bro.
Y'all not gonna trick me at dessert.
You ate the whole thing.
I'm not even gonna hold y'all like dead serious. After this, I'm probably just gonna like lay down and like listen to like Teddy Pendergrass and vibe out. Like, bird up. Like, I gotta have a whole moment.
Hey, we wanna thank everybody for participating.
Thanks for having us.
We wanna thank Chef Miguel.
Miguel, thank you.
For knocking it down.
I've been thinking about squirrels for like 30 minutes. You ever seen a black squirrel?
Yes.
How you feel when you've seen that black squirrel?
Represented.
Exactly. Way higher than I thought I was gonna be.